Would you stand with me and let's sing a couple of songs of praise. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. All right, just a little bit louder now. I can hear you, but just barely. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he's built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there this song of victory. Victory, oh victory. Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Here's another one I hope will be familiar. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer. This is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer. This is my plea. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. So let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. Surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Father, I hear it growing louder, the song of your redeemed, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts it comes an anthem, oh, hear the heavens ring. This is our song, song to our King. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. Let the worshipers arise, let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all, I surrender to the King once more. So let the worshipers arise. Amen.
Thank you, Rick, and thank you for being here tonight. As you came in, you may not have noticed we have a prayer guide. If you didn't get a copy of that, if you'll raise your hand up, we'll at least have one per family. Should have enough. If you'll raise your hand, I've got a few down here. If some of you could grab a couple of stacks of those prayer guides and bring them in, we'll make sure everybody gets one. And what we're going to do is use this just as a way of maintaining an up-to-date prayer ministry of our church. So if you see somebody as you glance over that needs to be on here that's not on here, make sure that they get added to that prayer guide. And if you see someone that maybe God's answered that prayer in one way or the other, that needs to be removed from it, if you'll let us know that, we'll make sure they get taken off as well. So we got some coming around. If you need one, raise your hand up and they'll bring one over to you. Also, while they're doing that, we always like to recognize and remember guests of honor when they come our way. We've got a very special person with us tonight. Miss Betty Sue Dunham is back there, and I'm told that she is a pastor's wife, a former pastor of this church, and so we're grateful that she's here tonight and her family. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for your ministry to this church through the years. So glance over the prayer guide. Obviously, we want to remember Miss Peters and her family have the privilege, the honor of being there tomorrow and be a part of that service. So be praying for that time. It was a sweet, sweet passing. If he was a friend of yours, you need to know that he was at peace when he went to be with the Lord. And just to think, at one moment, he was looking at the wall of the hospital, and the next moment, he saw the King of Glory. What an awesome, awesome thing to imagine. So, remember them in prayer. Who else would you like to add to the list tonight? If you glance over that and make sure they're not already on there. And if you see some that needs to be mentioned, please raise your hand and we'll get them added to it. Going once? All right, we got one right here. Say that. Melissa Skoll had surgery. Pray for her recovery. What else would you like to add? If I don't see you, just shout out. If you're new to Wednesday night, we're real informal on Wednesday night. We try to, at any time, if you want me to stop, slow down, ask a question, feel free to. Yes, ma'am. Gail Mason. We need to remember her family. Nixon. M-I-X-O-N? Okay. Gil Mixon family. Yes, ma'am. Pray for Zach. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we've been studying your kingdom and the full expression of your kingdom and a new heaven and a new earth. And God, all the things that we're praying for today, Lord, they're not in existence in that new heaven and new earth. Father, we thank you for that. We thank you that the time is coming when there will be no more cyst. There will be no more death. There will be no more families that we need to lift up because they've lost a loved one. And so, God, we rejoice in that. We say with John, thy kingdom come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. And Father, but we're not there yet. So we pray that a little bit of that kingdom would spill over into this world. And that it would just testify to the reality of your existence, to the love that you have for people. And so, God, we want to lift up these that have been mentioned tonight and these that are on our prayer guide, Lord, that, Father, where healing is needed, that you would be the great physician. Where comfort is needed, Lord, that you would be the precious comforter through the Holy Spirit. Father, where wisdom is needed, you told us to ask you that you give liberally. And so, Father, we ask you for wisdom in certain cases. Now, Father, as we look into your word tonight, Father, we pray that you would speak to us, that you would teach us, instruct us, and that, Father, we would leave here knowing you better and having our appetite wet. So this is not just the end, but this is the beginning of just stoking the fires and causing us to want to go further into your word and understand it and believe it with all of our heart. And to that end, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you're finding your place in God's word, and if you want to go ahead and turn there, let's see. We got through 2 Peter last week. Go ahead and find your place in Psalm 19. Psalm 19 would be the first passage we're in tonight. As you're finding your place there, let me just remind you that a lot is happening. God is working at First Baptist, and we're really wanting to cash in on that momentum that he's given us during this time. So the staff is very busy. We're really making sure that all of our cylinders are firing. We're trying our best to get everything done that we can get done by the time school starts back. So August the 6th is kind of our deadline to get a lot of things accomplished. So you're going to see, it's kind of a mess up here right now. We've been moving mulch around all day and trying to get that rolling. If you would like to be a part of that and help with that, they ask for people to come just as you're able and kind of spread that out over the flower beds. But that will be done real soon, and it'll look better by the time you get here on Sunday. Several other things around the campus that we're just tackling, trying to make sure we get it looking as good as we can by the time school starts back. Because here we think what's going to happen. You've already seen kind of a boost in numbers just getting a senior pastor. Last couple of weeks, we've been over 500. We believe we're going to get another boost right when school starts back. So you'd be inviting and you'd be reaching out to people. We're going to try to make sure that we're ready. You know, at my home, when company's coming, we really got to get stuff ready. Miss Julie gets in, you know, she gets in housekeeper mode and puts all of us in housekeeper mode. And that's kind of how I'm going to have to be, is just say, look, we got to get ready for company because company's coming. Amen. And we want to be ready for them when they get here. So there's a lot going on there. I've got a note. The senior adult team has decided to cancel the luncheon for tomorrow due to the funeral. And they're going to reschedule that for August the 3rd. So make sure that you're at that if you're a part of the senior adult ministry here. And where does that start? 45 and up. Is that right? It's older than me. That's all I know. It's older than me. All right. So if you're a part of that, you make sure. My daughter, she always tells me if she's in service, don't mention me. But I can't help it. So I can't help but mention my baby. But She came up to me the other day and she said, I can tell since we moved to Florida, your hair, it's getting lighter. And I said, well, it's all that chlorine. I said, you know, it's the sun and the chlorine and the swimming pools and all that kind of stuff. And she says, no, it's not getting blonder. She said, it's getting grayer. And I said, well, that's the Baptist's fault right there. No, I said, baby, that's blonde. That's not gray. And she said, well, no, it's not gray. She said, it's a little more white than gray. And I said, well, you can't win sometimes, you know. We are, speaking to kids, we have several people asking about Wednesday night service childcare. So that's something that we're working hard to. We're going to try to start that next week. So help us get the word out that if there's people who want to be here, we're going to try to have childcare together by then. If you want to help with that, get in touch with Shad, and we got to make sure we do the background checks and all that good stuff. So he has a little bit of a meeting with you that he kind of wants to go over the expectations there, and we'll make sure that those babies are taken care of. I loved what he said. He said, I don't want it just to be nursery. I want it to be a ministry. And so he's going to equip you so that you're able to minister to those kids while we're ministering to their parents in here. So make sure you reach out to him. You can go to the website and get his email or just catch him after service on Sunday. Let him know you're interested in helping there. Well, last week we began a study on God's Word. And we talked about what do we believe as Baptists about the Bible. And we kind of went through some introductory remarks about, you know, what the Bible is, where we got our Bible. We talked a little bit about the canon of Scripture, the Old Testament canon, the New Testament canon, why certain books are in the Bible, why certain books are not in the Bible. And we went through all of that last week. And this week, we're going to move into kind of our first points and talk about what do we as Southern Baptists believe about God's Word. And this is what you'll learn. Not all Christians are going to agree about Scripture. They're going to look at it a little bit different. Remember we talked about the three levels of beliefs last week? We said there's primary, secondary, and tertiary, right? Well, the doctrine of Scripture is secondary. It doesn't mean it's unimportant. It just means it's not gospel important. It's not going to save you. You can believe in the inerrancy of God's Word and not be a Christian. Do you understand that? I'll prove it to you. Satan believes every word of this book, and he's not one of us, all right? So you can believe right about this book and not be a Christian. Now, somebody may come to Christ and have a struggle with accepting the Bible as God's authoritative word, and they may need to grow in that area. But we as Southern Baptists, as a denomination, as a church, we have stated clearly what we believe about Scripture. And so tonight, I'm talking from that perspective, that this is what we as Southern Baptists believe about God's Word. Now, it's important. It's important that you understand this. You'll have friends who come from different denominations that believe a little differently. My mother grew up in a Methodist context, and it was a little different there. For example, the Methodists, when they baptize, what do? Generally, they sprinkle. Sometimes they will immerse if you request that they immerse, but generally they're going to sprinkle. The Presbyterians are going to sprinkle. Do you know why they do that? Convenience. Convenience? You're right, but I'm going to tell you why that they... As Baptists, have you ever thought, where do they see that in the Bible? Have you ever thought that, wondered that to yourself? Okay, well, let me show you why. And I'm saying this in a way of introduction so that you understand why this conversation is so very important. The Methodists would say they believe that God's Word is highly authoritative, is strongly authoritative, but they would also say that that tradition holds a lot of sway as well. And by tradition, I don't mean this type of music or that type of music. I'm talking about the tradition of over 2,000 years of church history. So, for example, there's a document called the Didache. The Didache. It's one of the oldest documents that we have outside of Scripture that we know where it came from. We know what its source was. It's not Bible. But it was one of the first documents that we have record of outside of Scripture that the church authorities sent out from Jerusalem. While the church was still, the power base was in Jerusalem. Eventually, the power base shifted from Jerusalem to the city of Rome. That's why you have a Roman Catholic church. But at this time, the power base of the church was the city of Jerusalem. Now, the church was spreading from Jerusalem to Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth, as Jesus commanded. They were taking the gospel into all the world, right? As they would go into these new parts, they began to have questions that weren't answered in the Scriptures. They weren't sure what to do. So, as it began to, the gospel began to spread into sub-Saharan Africa, they began to go into areas that, for example, didn't grow wheat. How do you do the Lord's Supper if they don't grow wheat? Any thoughts on that? Can you use, let's say, for example, if the main sustenance product of the area is rice, is it okay to substitute rice for bread? You say yes. Does anybody disagree? Anybody say no? You need to use bread because that's what Jesus and the disciples used. Does anybody hold to that? You're looking at me like you're setting us up for something, aren't you? I'm really not. No, I'm really not. I'm really just asking because this is the kind of stuff that the early church had to figure out. What do you do if there's not grape juice? We argued last week about red versus white. What if you don't grow grapes? Can you use pomegranate juice? Somebody said sure. Does anybody disagree with that? Well, I'm telling you, in the early church, these were big issues. Okay? These were big issues. Okay, and the one we're talking about tonight, baptism. You get into sub-Saharan Africa, and there's not an abundance of water. And the water you have, you got to be real careful with and make sure that you don't waste it. And so people are coming to Christ. They're professing faith. What if you don't have a river nearby to baptize them in? What do you do? Well, the early church missionaries would write back to the apostles or the church leaders that were in Jerusalem. By this time, the apostles had passed off the scene. And they were writing back to the pastors who were in Jerusalem and saying, what do we do? We don't have a lot of water at times in these missionary fields. What do we do? Well, the Didache was the answer. The Didache was written to help them figure out what do you do when there's not grapes to make wine with or grape juice with? What do you do when there's not bread, there's not wheat to make bread with? What do you do when there's not water to baptize with? The writers of the Didache said, when possible, it is much, and I'm not quoting it exactly, but you can go back and read this online, and this is the gist of it. If at all possible, baptize in living water. You know what living water means? Running water. Now, they felt like that was important, that it was running water, if at all possible. They said, but if it's not possible, then still water will suffice. If there's not an abundance of still water, then fill a jar with water and pour it over the head of the convert in the name of the Father, fill it up again, in the name of the Son, fill it up again, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Okay? So, that was the Didache. They were trying to make an accommodation for baptism in the case of these areas that didn't have an abundance of water. So, the missionary gets the Didache, and they begin to discuss, well, do we do this or not? Nobody did it. Everybody said, we would feel more comfortable sticking with what the Word of God says than to make this accommodation. All right? So they didn't do it. A couple of hundred years passed. The church in that area began to grow, and a man named Novatian came onto the scene. Novatian had a situation in a church where a gentleman was dying, and he was not a Christian. And he wanted to be baptized. He wanted to profess faith. Now, you gotta put yourself in the position of this pastor. The pastor goes to him, and the man's about to die, and oh yeah, he's extremely wealthy. And if he dies as a Christian, he's going to leave a great inheritance to the church. Pastor goes and he visits with him. He wants to lead him to Christ, but there's a problem. He's so sick that he cannot be baptized. So Novation is looking and he's trying to figure out, what do I do? How do I accommodate this? We want him to get saved, and we really would like to have that money. I mean, they had debts just like we've got, you know? And what do we do? And somebody says, well, you know, there's a document called the Didache. And it made some allowance there. Novation is still very concerned, and he's not sure he wants to do this. His conscience is bothering him. And he says, okay, here's what we'll do. I'm going to baptize you with the innovation provided by the Didache. But if you don't die, you have to promise me that you'll get baptized by immersion. The guy says, sure. So he baptized him, poured water over him in the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit, got the church in his will, all is good. The guy doesn't die, he lives. And he looks at the pastor, and the pastor says, praise God, you lived. Now come get baptized. And he says, no, I don't want to get baptized. And it opened the door for what became known as Novation's innovation. And still, it did not become church norm until about 1000 AD. You don't see people baptizing by sprinkling. Even the good old Roman Catholic Church immersed up until about 1,000 years after the scriptures were complete. So you go to a Methodist and you say, well, why do y'all sprinkle? Most members in a Methodist church have no idea. They really don't know. The pastors may or may not, but generally it's because they look at tradition, extra-biblical tradition, extra-biblical writings, and say, well, God speaks through that as well. So he speaks through his word, and he speaks through that as well. Okay, the Reformation happened, and a lot of things in the Reformation were all about what does the Bible say, because the Roman Catholic Church and the Pope was saying something over here, the Word of God was saying something different. And so Luther and the Protestant Reformers, they went back to the doctrine of sola scriptura in Latin, and that means that Scripture is the highest authority. Okay? So they took them back to the Bible, back to the book. But they didn't reform baptism. They continued to sprinkle. That's why your Lutherans and your Presbyterians and all of these groups that came out of the Reformation still did that. They still sprinkle. They didn't go far enough in that regard. But a group came along that said, no, we're going to go all the way. We're going to do what the Bible says, and we're going to do it because we see it not only as the highest authority, but in the areas it addresses, it's the only authority. And that was the Baptist. That's where we came from. And our name came from, we're baptizing again. Because everybody in that day and time in the Holy Roman Empire was baptized as a baby. You were born into the church and you were baptized. And the Baptist said, no, we don't accept that baptism. We're going to again baptize. The Anabaptists were again baptizers. They're not our only forefathers, but they're one of them. So they baptized again, adult converts. Why? Because, not because of a conviction about baptism, but a conviction about the book. Does that make sense? So there's so many things you'll look at. Church authority, church government. If you go to the Roman Catholic Church, there's a very clear form of government. Earthly speaking, at the top of the Roman Catholic Church is the Pope. And then below that, some of you will know this better than I will, cardinals, bishops, all the way down to local pastors and deacons and priests and that sort of thing. But there's a very clear top-down government. The Baptist church turns the pyramid upside down. So we've got a Southern Baptist Convention president. Steve Gaines is your Southern Baptist Convention president. But our churches are congregational. Ultimately, they're congregational. And then our forms of authority serve the congregation as a whole. Why? It's because we believe that's what the Bible teaches. Does that make sense? Now, if Steve Gaines, if the Pope walks into the Roman Catholic Church, guess who the boss is at that point? The Pope. If Steve Gaines walks into a Baptist church, you know what he is? A visitor. He's welcome, and I'll give him the pulpit in a heartbeat, but he has no authority in this church. Zero. The Southern Baptist Convention has zero authority over you. You're an autonomous body of believers that decide the path you want to walk in by conviction. Does that make sense? And so all of these things go back to, do we hold to the Scripture as the primary source of revelation or not? And that conviction that the Bible is God's Word is why we do what we do as Southern Baptists. And that's very important to remember. Now, the principle that drives all of that is called the regulative principle. Regulative, like regulate, regulative principle. I'm not going to try to spell it, all right? The regulative principle is the principle that says Scripture regulates our practice as a church. Now, there's two perspectives on that principle. One is to say, we only do what the Bible says, period. If the Bible doesn't tell us to do it, we don't do it. I'll tell you an example of that, Church of Christ. How many of you have family in the Church of Christ? Do they don't have musical instruments, do they? And a lot of them. I mean, you know, if they have a guitar in the Church of Christ, that's a liberal Church of Christ. But the reason they don't is because, there's not a verse in the New Testament that says we're supposed to have musical instruments. So they take the regulative principle to that perspective. Most Baptists are going to look at the regulative principle and say, if it was a big deal to God, he addressed it in the Scriptures, and he gives some liberty in the areas he didn't address. So he didn't command us not to have musical instruments. And we see in the Old Testament they had musical instruments. So we have musical instruments in most of our churches. It's the same principle. It's still letting the Scripture be the boss, but it's saying, it's kind of like your kids saying, well, if it's a big deal to mom and dad, they'll tell us about it. And if it's not a big deal, then they're going to kind of give us some liberty there. And I've always argued, well, if you want to hold the other perspective that you got to do exactly what the book says, electric light is not in the New Testament. Right? And so, you know, how do you decide what to do and what not to do there? So the regulative principle is saying the Scripture regulates faith and practice, and we as Baptists tend to hold to the conviction that if God forbid it, we forbid it. If God commanded it, we command it. And if God didn't address it, we give liberty. And so that's what gets you to that third level of saying, look, there's liberty in some areas because Scripture is not super clear on it, and so there may be a little disagreement there, and that's okay. So that's where we're at. So this is new material tonight, a little bit of recap, a little bit of new material. The convictions we have, five words are used to describe our convictions on the Bible. We believe the Bible is inspired, inerrant, infallible, authoritative, and sufficient. Now, you remember those words. And if you fall out of bed in the middle of the night, quote all five of them before you hit the ground, all right? Inspired, inerrant, authoritative, infallible, sufficient. Remember those words. Let's go through each one. Number one, the Bible is inspired. It is inspired. Now, this means more than to say Shakespeare was an inspired playwright. It's more than saying, boy, that sunset was inspiring. It's more than that. It literally means the human authors wrote down what the divine author wanted them to write. We believe in verbal plenary inspiration of Scripture. That is, not just the ideas were conveyed, but the actual words are inspired of God. Now, it does not mean that the biblical writers were receiving audible instruction and writing by dictation. We don't. That's not what we mean by inspiration. They were writing with the full use of their faculties, and their personality came through in their writing. So it wasn't like a robotic download from heaven. Incidentally, that's what the Muslims believe about the Quran. They believe that it was dictated, that it was given by dictation. But the biblical writers, it shows their own personality, their own perspective. In the same way, if you were writing a letter or a novel, your personality would come through as well. But the Holy Spirit was using them to convey the very words that he wanted to speak to his people. As such, it's considered special revelation. Now, there's a measure of revelation that's called natural revelation. That is, you know, God speaks through his creation. If you're a scientist, you can discover things about God from looking at the veins of a leaf or from studying the galaxy. They both speak truth about who God is. Psalm 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day they pour out speech, and night to night it reveals knowledge. There is no speech, there are no words whose voice it is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and the words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun. Paul writes in Romans 1:19. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So there's things about God that you can learn just from observing creation. And nobody should know that better than you folks who see the beauty of God's creation on such a regular basis. Those are natural revelation. And you can learn about God through natural revelation, but you can't come to a saving knowledge of God through natural revelation. It requires special revelation. And that's what the Bible is. It's special revelation. If there was no sin nature, if you weren't affected by sin, hypothetically, you might could go out and learn all you needed to know about God just by observing. Because the creation is speaking that clearly. But because of sin, you need a special, clear revelation. Somebody asked me one time, they said, well, suppose someone is out on an island, out in the Atlantic somewhere that we haven't discovered, and they don't have a Bible. Can they be saved? Listen, according to what I understand from God's Word, not without the gospel. They can't just look at creation and come to a saving knowledge of God. You say, well, what if the Holy Spirit's working and drawing them and convicting them? Are you telling me that God's going to let them go to hell? I'm telling you, no. God's going to move on a Baptist church, and they're going to get generous, and they're going to give their life, and they're going to send out missionaries, and they're going to get the gospel to that person. That's why we do missions. Do you see? That's why we have that conviction. If we believe they could come to a saving knowledge of God without the truth of the Scriptures, we ought not go, because we're making them accountable. But if we believe that no one comes to the Father but through the Son, and you have to have a certain amount of understanding of who He is, then we have to go. We have to equip, and we have to send out missionaries to go into all the world. The Bible is inspired. The phrase, thus saith the Lord, occurs over 400 times in your Bible. God said occurs 46 times. 2 Timothy 3:16. You know John 3:16. Let me encourage you to also memorize 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. When God sends us the people that He's sending us now, that He will be sending us in the days ahead, don't make me a liar when I tell people, if you get up an hour early and come to our small groups, our Sunday school, what do y'all call them? Life groups? I call it Sunday school. So y'all know what I'm talking about. If they come to Sunday school, give them the word. Amen? Give them the word. Don't just give them pretty poems and talk about football. Give them the word. Give them the word. It's inspired. And then I'm going to group these next two together because they're similar, but I'm going to qualify each one. It's inerrant and infallible. To say that the scriptures are true, and to say that is to say that the scriptures are true and accurate without a mixture of error. Remember the first question that Satan raised in the garden. Did God really say that? And what we're saying is, yes, he did. Yes, he did. This is what God has said. Inerrancy has reference to the individual words, typically, and infallibility has reference to the Bible as a whole. So when you say inerrant, you're talking word for word. When you say infallible, you're talking about the message of the Bible as a whole. Now, when we talk about, in a theological setting, when we talk about inerrancy, we're not talking about our translation of the Scripture generally. Most people aren't. They're talking about the original autographs, okay? It's just important to keep in mind, we're saying that what Paul wrote down was inerrant. This is not, this is a translation of the inerrant. But is it hypothetically possible that the translators got it wrong? Yes, it's possible. It's possible. That's why it's good to have multiple translations, because you can compare them. Now, it's very highly unlikely that all of them got it wrong. This in the same way, but in the original autographs, they were inerrant. In Psalm 12, verse 6, psalmist writes, "The word of the Lord, the words of the Lord are pure words, like refined silver in a furnace on the ground, purified seven times." The actual words. John 17, 17, "Sanctify them in truth. Thy word is truth." James 1:25 calls the Scripture the perfect law of God. Hebrews 6:18 says that it's impossible for our God to tell a lie. The definition in simple terms means that the Bible always tells the truth about everything concerning everything that it speaks to. Now, it does not mean that the Bible tells us every fact that you could possibly know about any given subject. If your car is running hot, don't look for a verse to fix it. We over-spiritualize the things sometimes, don't we? If you've got radiator problems, you probably need to take it to a mechanic or look at the owner's manual. To say that the Bible is perfect doesn't mean it speaks to everything that there is in life. But the areas it speaks about perfectly. That's what it means. Does that make sense? The areas that it addresses without any mixture of error. The Bible can be inerrant. A few things to keep in mind. The Bible can be inerrant and still speak in the ordinary language of everyday speech. So the biblical writers, to say that it's inerrant doesn't mean that they're speaking as scientists when they say the sun rises and the sun sets. That's just ordinary. From their perspective, it does. And that's what they're looking at, and that's what they're seeing. It's ordinary language, ordinary speech. The rain falling, from their perspective, is falling. And they're seeing it, and they're writing what they're seeing. The Bible can be inerrant and still use cultural norms. For example, there will be times that you'll read through the Bible, and they will round numbers up or down. That was very normal in that day. It's normal in our day. If I say, how many people were in church Sunday? Around 500. Well, I can't prove that to you. I'm confident it's not exactly 500. But it's just cultural norm for us to use that kind of speech. Does that make sense? And it was very normal for them to do the same. A lot of times you'll see the New Testament quoting the Old Testament without being precise. They won't quote it word for word perfectly. But that was a cultural norm in that day. You didn't have a copy and paste like you do in our day. So it was very normal for them to get the gist of it right and not quote it perfectly. That doesn't make it an error in Scripture. It's still inerrant. The Bible can be inerrant and still honor the particular nuances of the genre. We talked about genre last week. Every genre is going to have nuances to it that it's going to honor. So things like we said last week, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. We know that he's not talking literally there. He doesn't literally make you lie down in the middle of a pasture. But it's poetic language, and that's okay. It's still inerrant. And within that particular genre, it's most certainly without error. So the Bible is inspired, it's inerrant, it's infallible. Fourthly, it's authoritative. Bernard Ramm describes authority this way. He says, authority itself means that the right or power to command an action or compliance or determine belief or custom, expecting obedience from those under such authority. That's what the Bible is claiming. It has the authority to command. Now, when it comes down to pastoral authority, my authority ultimately begins and ends right here. I can command where he commands. Now, I can give you wisdom and tell you that nobody wants this church to succeed any more than I do, and I can give you some you know, perspective from 30,000 feet that this is how I think things ought to go, and it would be wise to follow your pastor, and the Bible has spoken and said you ought to follow those that God has placed over you. That's what it says. And so that's the truth, but I can't come to you and say, you need to sell your car, you need to buy a Chevrolet. Now I can make a recommendation. And all the Chevy folks said, amen. But I can't command you in an area. Why? If I said that, the next words out of your mouth is, where's your verse? Have you got a verse on that? You're speaking it very authoritatively. Do you have a verse on it? No, I don't. I have a verse to command you in that area. And so if I say that, I can say, hey, I recommend you ought to do this. Or, you know, just as a brother to brother, I think you should do this. And I trust your advice in the same way. If you're blessed in a certain area and God's shown that you're good at something, I want to hear what you've got to say about it. I want to hear Rick's thoughts on worship. I want to hear Steve's thoughts on real estate. I need to learn and listen. But when I'm speaking from God's word, I can speak with great authority because it is the authority. And my word is just his word. When I'm speaking his word, that's where the authority comes from. The Bible is authoritative. 1 Corinthians 14:37. If anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I'm writing to you, Paul speaking, I'm writing as a command of the Lord. We preach the word, and we preach it with authority. And when you teach the word, I never apologize for it. If you've got it right, now if you don't know you've got it right, if you may be misunderstanding it, feel free to say, I think this is what it's saying, I'm not sure. Because sometimes that's just honest. But if you know, thus saith the Lord, say it with authority. Speak it with conviction. Fifthly, the Bible is sufficient. That is to say, it's sufficient in the areas that it claims sufficiency. The Bible is not sufficient to do a root canal or to change the oil on your car. But it's sufficient in the areas of faith and practice and the areas where it says it's sufficient to build your home on. If you want to know how to do family, it's sufficient because it claims sufficiency in that area. If you want to know how to parent your children, if you want to know how to advise your children about your grandchildren, the Bible is sufficient. Give them God's word. It's sufficient in the areas where it speaks. 2 Timothy 3:15. Paul writing to Timothy, he says, and from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, speaking of the scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation in Christ Jesus. So many times you'll find that people will come to you and they'll say, well, you know, the Bible is good. We love the Bible. But, you know, there's this other book. There's the Pearl of Great Price. And it may be the purpose-driven life. It could be anything. There's this other book. And those other books, if they're a good and godly book, they can be helpful, but they're not sufficient, authoritative, and inspired, and inerrant. And what you will find is, if another book comes along, it's either going to echo what's in this book, or it's going to contradict it. If you read the Book of Mormon, if you read the Pearl of Great Price, all of those things, you're going to find that there's either going to be just they're repeating what's already here, or they're contradicting what's already here. And if they repeat it, they're unnecessary. And if they contradict it, they're untrustworthy. And so just keep that in mind. That's what we mean by sufficiency. This book is all you need to know God as much as you really can know about God. You can get from this book. Now, other books may help you understand this book, and that's good and helpful. But if they're trying to add to it, that's where it's problematic. That's saying that this book is not enough. So does that make sense? Okay. Questions about the Bible, questions about sufficiency, inerrancy, any of this stuff we've talked about tonight. Now next week, we're going to go further into why do we believe this? Do we believe it because the preacher said so? No, there's reasons that we believe this. We're going to unpack that next week. But tonight, before I unpack the why, I wanted to unpack the what. Here's what we believe. Now, next week, why do we believe? Why are we of that conviction? And what do we say if somebody challenges that conviction? Have you learned, have you listened to people long enough on this island to realize that this is a spiritual group? That doesn't mean they're a Christian group. They're into spirituality. But you get from your spiritual guru, and I'll get from my spiritual guru, and you pray to your God, and I'll pray to my God, and I'm sure your God's listening, and my God will listen. I hear that all the time here. And it's very out of step with the culture to say, this is God's word, and God isn't speaking through the spiritual guru something that's contradictory to this book. But that's the truth, and that's what Amelia Island, North Florida needs to hear. Any questions tonight? Yes, ma'am.
In Romans 20, when you read that one of that, the part where it says, so they were that excuse, that just means his existence. They could somehow
they are accountable to the reality of God based upon creation alone. So they are without excuse to become idolaters. If you look at the whole context of Romans there, it says they worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator who is blessed forever. And Paul is arguing that the heavens declare the glory of the unseen God. The heavens declare his reality. So these people who've chosen to worship the creature rather than the creator, and God has turned them over to their passions. He's arguing that they are without excuse. He's not arguing that they can look at the heavens and see the gospel and come to a saving knowledge of Christ. Okay, so he's arguing to a different point there. Yes, sir. Very good question. Okay, so his question is, we talked about the gentleman on the island, and we said he can't come to a saving knowledge of Christ without the gospel. What do you do with someone who's dies prematurely, someone who dies in the womb? Everything that we have in Scripture leads me to believe that that child is safe. Not saved, but safe. He's not been converted. I'm not saying he's been converted, but I'm saying he's safe. Here's why I believe that. David, in his sin with Bathsheba, she got pregnant. And Nathan the prophet comes and speaks to David. And he says, part of the penalty of your sin is that child's going to die. David begins to seek after God and weep and fast. And he wouldn't eat, he wouldn't bathe, he just crying out to God to save that baby. And God's word comes to pass, the child dies. The people in his entourage are standing outside the room, and David's broken, weeping, and the child has died. And they look at David and say, well, if he does this, if he's broken and weeping and crying out to God while the child is sick, what's he going to do when the child dies? And he overhears them. And he looks up and he says, what's happened? And they said, my king, the child has passed. And David does the most odd thing. He gets up and washes his face and sits down and eats supper. And they said, David, that makes no sense. You were broken when he was sick. When he dies, you set up, you go on with your life. And David said, oh, yeah, he's not going to come to where I am, but I'm going to go to where he is. One day I'm going to see him again. So David was of the conviction that that child was in heaven. Okay, I'll show you another one from the life of David. And there's a lot of scriptures I could point to. He said with Absalom, when Absalom died, Absalom was the rebel. He was the one who wanted to rule and be the boss, and he did not want to follow the appointed authority of God. When he died, David said, it's over. I'll never see him again. Why? That boy was in hell. So this grown man who had rejected God's authority, David said, died and went to hell. But this little baby who was innocent, David said, went to heaven. Now, why and how does that work? I don't know, but I'm telling you, that's what it says. In Nineveh, when Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh, he went to Tarshish. And God says, why won't you speak my word to these people? And he quotes a number. Some of you may know the number. I don't remember. He said, I have like 40,000 of my children on in that great city who don't know their left hand from their right hand. He said, they're mine. You see, I don't want to judge that city. I don't want to judge the great city of Nineveh because I have children. Babies are there. And if you don't have compassion on the adults, have compassion on the babies. So you see those kind of things that tend to lead you to believe that there's something unique. You say, well, what's that age of accountability? We're not given an age. But there does seem to be. I look at when the Bible predicts the coming of Jesus and says a virgin will be with child, you should call his name Emmanuel. It speaks of a time where he will know enough to receive the good and reject the evil. And there seems to be an age where there's a moral reasoning and accountability that a child comes to that brings him into some sense of accountability before God. Okay? Great question. And those kind of questions are important to answer biblically, not just to say, well, I just don't think God would do that. Does that make sense? You don't want to answer it that way. You want to say, show me something to show me why you don't think God would do that. Very good question. What else? We got about a minute. I'm going to let you out on time. I told you. All right? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for my church family. And God, I thank you that in just a very short time, God, you've knit our hearts together, and I love this people, and I sense love, God, from them. And Father, I just pray that that would be increasing, and that, God, we would serve one another well, we would serve you well, and God, we would reach out to our loved ones on this island, in Yulee, in North Florida, and all around the world. And God, it could be here tonight that there is a man, there's a woman that you're impressing upon a call to do something unique and different. And maybe take the gospel to somebody who hasn't heard it. Father, I've heard it said that nobody should hear the gospel twice until everybody hears it once. And oh God, we've heard it millions of times. But there's places on this earth that do not know Jesus ever walked. Lord, don't let us be comfortable with that. But move upon us to take the gospel to those people. Father, there might be somebody in that youth group tonight. Father, there might be somebody that would be here tonight and would sense your call if we had people to volunteer for nursery. And I know some people tonight are going to sense a call to do that. And I pray they would be obedient. Now, Father, as we break the huddle, as we take the field, God, we pray that we would do so a little more understanding of who you are and what you've spoken than when we came in. And bless us as we go. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. As always, we'll have somebody at the back to receive an offering, I think. Are we good with that, guys? We got somebody with a plate back there. We're good to go back there. Okay, now that's just a reminder. That's if you weren't able to give last Sunday or you plan to give this Sunday and you're not able. It's not a second offering. This is just all going into the same bucket. If you need prayer, I hang around after the service every week. If there's anything I can talk to you about, on Sunday morning, I'll be back there. But tonight, I'll be up here. If you need me, you come by and let me know how I can pray for you or answer questions for you. All right? God bless you. Have a great week.